Well, that was disappointing. And it's not like it's bad, because God, I've seen worse. It just doesn't feel like a Castlevania sequel, except when it comes to the animation, that was still incredible. And the voice acting too, I guess. It's basically a shadow of what Castlevania was like. It lacks everything else the original had, the interesting character arcs, the philosophical dialogue, even the humor is not as good as the original. But despite all this, I'd still recommend it. But no need to rush, really. It's not that great. It's just okay. Though I think you'll enjoy it more if you haven't watched the original series. That I highly recommend you do, because it's really, really good. It's not perfect, however. I mean, season 3 exists. And now that I think about it, Nocturne kinda reminded me of season 3 of Castlevania. I started watching it expecting a masterpiece like the previous ones, but instead got a confusing mess. But at least Castlevania had some issues with production because of COVID. And it still managed to deliver something great. What's Nocturne's excuse? But it's fine, really. It's still good, and maybe it'll get better in season 2. And I know you'll enjoy it better if you haven't watched the first Castlevania, that I once again recommend you do. It's one of the best shows out there, you won't regret it. And with that being said, I will spoil the entire show, so if you haven't watched Nocturne yet, stop watching. Unless you don't care, of course. In this case, I'll start the review with episode 1, A Common Enemy in Evil. It starts in the US of A with a little Rector Belmont and his mother, Julia, on their way to send him away to France, despite his objections, until they were stopped by a vampire named Olrax, who's really hot by the way, and he managed to defeat Julia and kill her to avenge his lover, all in front of Rector, who of course was traumatized by all of this, and to top it all off, Olrax told him that he will kill him too, just not now. And I liked that at first. I like a villain with a set of morals, no matter how twisted they may be, but it wasn't really the case here, and they butchered Olrax completely as the main villain. But I'm getting ahead of myself. For now, we move to France 9 years later, before the revolution, where the aristocrats are literal vampires, and the people are preparing for said revolution. But do not be fooled, for there are no French people here, only British people who occasionally speak some broken French. I always find it funny when English-speaking people try to speak French, so I don't care about the inaccuracy here. And I play it again. Vive la Révolution! Okay, I'm done. And then they got attacked by some vampires sent by the aristocrats. But lucky for them, there is a magician and a vampire hunter amongst them, who's Richter and his sister, kinda, I guess, Maria. And they mentioned something about a vampire messiah that will plunge the world into darkness.
You will suffer and die.
That makes absolutely no sense.
Yes, Richter, you're right. I thought we're gonna focus on the revolution and Olrax. That's what the trailer showed. So why the fuck did they add a new villain? And they immediately abandon everything to deal with this new threat. And all I could hope for is that they don't fuck this up, and, well, I think you know they kinda did. But anyway, they got worried about this messiah person, so they go discuss it with the abbot, despite their opposing beliefs. And he agrees to help them investigate, for they have a common enemy. How nice of him! And afterwards, we get to see the rich drinking the blood of a peasant they caught. Yay! And then Richter and Maria went home to her mother, Terra, who seemed to really trust the abbot.
The abbot's a good man, Maria.
Yes, I'm sure he was very handsome 16 years ago. I'm not saying he's not handsome now, I'm just trying to make a point. If you don't get it, you will soon. But no matter, they got attacked by night creatures, but they didn't know what they are at first, which I thought was weird, but then again, it's not like Richter had access to the Belmont Library, so it's understandable. Anywho, they all collectively fought them, they were on the brink of losing, Richter sees a flashback of his mom and is saved by Annette and Edward. Well, mainly Annette, because Edward can't really do anything. And I know what you're thinking. Why the hell is he here then? Well, dear viewer, the answer is not good reasons. But for now, they told them that they're looking for a Belmont and they're here because of the goddamn Messiah. And we cut to all Rags arriving to France, and boy, I can't wait to see the confrontation between him and Richter now that he's older. I really hope I won't be disappointed. Anyway, that the episode ends. So we move on to episode 2, Horror Beyond Nightmares. It starts with the abbot giving a sermon in his church about how terrible the revolution is, and that there will be a new Joan of Arc that would put an end to these liberals. And her name is Doralta, and she's a vampire who killed a bunch of guards who stopped her when she arrived in Paris. It was awesome. She was awesome. I liked her. She's not really the Joan of Arc though. I just wish it was her. We move on to Richter and the rest of the group having breakfast. And I have to say, everything looks gorgeous here. It's got more vibrant colors than the original. And I know it was intentional because everything was shit. But I like this. The animation is definitely an improvement. But the dialogue is... meh. They just talk about their revolution in Saint-Domingue. And Maria intends to use Annette and Edouard to inspire the revolution there, in France. She knows who the revolution was against, right? But that doesn't really matter, like the Messiah that they knew about from a priestess who predicted them and asked Annette to seek help from Richter, who can't use magic anymore and therefore is considered useless. Which is absolute bullshit, because Trevor couldn't use magic at all and was very useful, thank you very much. They just wanted to incorporate his magic abilities with his character arc, and I found it lazy, honestly. And then they go back to talk about the Messiah, and they mentioned her name.
Elizabeth Better.
Which causes Tira to break down and run away. You know what that means, we'll get a backstory! So she was living in Russia with her family, who, despite being a clan of speakers, remained there to help the people, until they were attacked by Elizabeth's soldiers and captured her sister. And she attempted to rescue her, only to realize that she was too late, for she was turned into a vampire. So she killed her out of mercy, really, and escaped west to France and never mentioned her past again. And to their credit, it doesn't really fall under the parent withholding vital information from their children to protect them or whatever bullshit reason cliche. So it's fine. And then Richter tells her that she knows how she feels, which sums up his purpose in these first episodes really. And now they know exactly who they're dealing with and that she's a monster and whatnot.
But we will defeat her.
Sure you can. And then Maria buried her bird creature that died in the last episode, and she's been contemplating what to do with it ever since. I didn't mention it because it doesn't really matter, and I'm mentioning it now because this funeral scene with Edward singing feels a little awkward, like, why are we doing this? And right afterwards, they went to spy on the vampires in the chateau. But lo and behold, Annette saw her mother's killer and got angry and used her powers unconsciously and revealed them, so they ran away. But not without a casualty. Guess who it is? Come on, it's Edward. Of course it's Edward. That's his whole purpose. To fucking die. And now Annette is sad and Edward gets turned into a night creature by the abbot. Oh no, I did not see it coming at all. And I have my reservation about his Iron Maiden thing that he's using as a tool, but they're not important for now, that is. But I do like his design. And with that, the episode ends. So we move on to episode 3, Freedom Was Sweeter. And it starts with Annette mourning the loss of Edward and everyone trying to comfort her.
None of this is your fault.
It's not any of your faults, actually. It's the fault of this crazy-ass writing. And then she starts telling her backstory and how she met Edward. Sure, we got time for another flashback. And it's actually good, for the most part. So Richter tells her that they'll avenge him, and we move on to Ms. Rack, and oh hey, look, it's all Rags. He was just wondering why the abbot is forging night creatures, and then they get into an altercation, and then they made up, and then they make out. Off screen, obviously. And I really don't care about them. They barely interacted. What do you want me to do? And then we cut to Dralta FaceTiming Erzabeth, and she mentions that she will make every king, emperor, and sultan kiss her feet. And that's it. And we move on to Annette giving a speech to motivate the people about the revolution, while simultaneously the abbot is giving a sermon about how they should stop this nonsense. Again. And then night creatures attacked them, so they fought them, and it was really cool, amazing even, I loved it. But then Annette recognized Edward, who seemed to recognize her as well, and protected her from an attack, and that got him carried away by his fellow night creatures to their master, and...
My sweet, beautiful Edward's been turned into a monster conjured from hell!
You know that means he went to hell, right? What, too soon? And then we move to episode 4, Horrors Rising from the Earth. And it starts with the abbot basically tormenting Edward, but he doesn't see him as an actual person with feelings anyway, so he doesn't really know what he's doing to him. And then it cuts to the group contemplating whether the abbot is involved with the Forgemaster or is imprisoned by them.
That's impossible. He's a good man.
The answer might surprise you. And then there's Annette, who wants to go back to Edward and save him, or at least kill him out of mercy, of course. And Richter being against this because they almost died the last time, so he insisted on formulating a plan.
So you're afraid.
And I know that she's being kind of a bitch.
We have magic. Or three of us do.
Okay, maybe a real bitch. But I wouldn't go as far as calling her the Amber of Castlevania. Because unlike Amber, her lashing out is understandable. She lost someone she loved in a horrible way, who then came back to life as a freak of nature, and Richter kept telling her that maybe she was just imagining it. And while it doesn't excuse it, it makes it a bit understandable. And that makes it better in my opinion. And while she doesn't apologize, she becomes a bit more understanding. For now, that is. And then Terra puts an end to their bickering and reveals that she knows the secret passageway to the church and that she'll go with them to help. How convenient! So they go to that entrance and the fuck, it's in the middle of the fucking road! Never mind. They go inside and then we cut to the abbot meeting Dralta with, I'm assuming as Luis says, but... they all have the same fucking haircut, so I don't know. They just bicker for a while about their religious beliefs and agree to disagree, for they share a common enemy.
The people.
So they just move on to see the beast the abbot made, and I like Dalta's light flirting with Mizrak.
You, handsome, feisty, glowering one.
Yeah, that's how I would describe him. Meanwhile, the group already arrived at the night creature's location. Edward starts singing because it's part of his old self and a huge fight scene ensues. The song was good, I guess, and Olrax is there too. Hooray! And then they come across the abbot and the rest and ooh, I wonder what this shot of him and Terra means. And the real fighting begins, but before that Annette goes to Edward and then he remembers her, but she said that she'll put an end to it and make it quick and then...
Come back! I'm sorry, Edward. I thought it's what you wanted.
Okay, this is good. And the voice acting helps a lot with this. And then Dralta injures Maria and the abbot stopped her from going further.
The slaughter of children isn't part of our bargain.
Yeah, right. But she goes and tries to kill Annette and... it was awesome. Oh hey, what's Richter doing?
I'm Richter Belmont.
Is this where that scene is? Talk about a disappointment. Okay, now I'm sure his Louis says. And the abbot actually seemed to feel bad about his actions, which is new since in the previous series, the church members felt no remorse about their actions, for they were in the name of God. So this was interesting to me. Unfortunately, it doesn't really get explored, so... meh.
Little boy Belmont.
Oh, hi, Olrax! Aww, are you going to curl him now? or do anything really, and now he's gone. Don't give him that look, you traumatized him. And they all ran after him, and now Aurax formally introduced himself to Drolta so he could see Erzabeth. And I liked that he threw Luis's head like a football. And then the group emerges from the ground and can't seem to find Richter.
He ran the fuck away!
Yeah, she was a bit of a bitch here too, and it continues to episode 5, The Natural Order, with Richter running away to a lake and breaking down and crying. Oh, poor baby. And we cut to the trio tending to Maria's wounds with magic. Cool. And now we cut to a funeral, and it was hilarious.
I can't abide tears, Nikolai.
Yeah, I doubt the real Marie Antoinette even liked him. And this one is a vampire. And now it's time for Annette to be a bitch again.
I'm not upset. I'm furious.
Okay, that's not too bad.
Do you need to wait for Richter before you do everything? He ran away.
Okay, I know it looks bad, but to her, she was also scared and experienced what Richter have. And maybe worse, since she had no one to take care of her afterwards. But she didn't abandon anyone because of it. So she was comparing him to herself. And didn't realize that everyone is different, but she will soon, so it's okay, I guess. So she goes anyway and comes across Drolta and decides to follow her. Oh, hi, Aurax!
I prefer my blood blue.
Aw, he's colorblind. And he goes on a walk with Drolta, and I actually enjoyed their conversation. It's not thought-provoking like the original, but it's still nice. Drolta reveals that she was a priestess in an Egyptian temple for the goddess Sekhmet, thousands of years ago. She's thousands of years old, and it's not revealed yet, but Erzabeth's powers stem from Sekhmet, so I assume she's thousands of years old as well. Which got me thinking, where the hell was she in the first series? Did she just sleep through Dracula and the final boss? Because I can't think of anything else really, since she's so powerful and all. But it's fine, I'll ignore this. And Annette's former master, who was conveniently there as well.
Last time I saw you, you were with that mulatto boy.
Yeah, okay. He tried to scare her by reminding her of her past, but she manages to trap him with these grasses she put around him. Good thing these grasses worked, because the ones on every fucking gravestone here didn't. And then he kept telling her that she'll never be free because slavery is a natural order and Erzabeth will restore it since she's a goddess because she drank the blood of Sekhmet, which again, when did that happen? Not before the first series, I hope. And she told him that the sun always rises to devour the darkness, so she will be defeated anyway. And then he dies. Yay! We then cut to Richter, who is seemingly in a village where the revolution succeeded, judging by the engravings here.
You have to be a man to be fraternity. In his brotherhood.
Oh my god, they're French! Why are you explaining this to them?
Oh, suits you.
The fucking what? This is where his headband came from! Isn't that nice? And that's all there is to this scene, trust me. And now we cut to Terra and Maria being visited by the abbot, and Terra reluctantly lets in him in. And she lashes out on him along with Maria for what he did. But he tries to defend himself, saying he's doing it for God and whatnot. And it escalates to...
If you hadn't met me, we wouldn't have Maria.
I know I shouldn't be interrupting, but I gotta say, I want to see their story. Like, really. It's not like there's much to offer in this show anyway, so I want at least some good romance. Also, I called it, and Maria is shocked to say the least and runs away.
I promise you, Terra, I will keep her safe.
Sure, buddy. We cut to Richter again in a bar or a restaurant, I can't tell. But he doesn't have enough money to order anything.
But the man over there says put it on his tab.
Aw, how sweet! And I love that he just gobbles it up. He sure is hungry. He goes then to thank the stranger, and he just...
Go back to where you came from and don't expect another one.
Dick. And then a vampire barges in and he kills him. You guessed it, that Dick is a Belmont. And I guess they tried to make him more like Trevor, but here's the thing. He's not Trevor and he'll never be Trevor, so stop fucking trying so hard. His name is Just, by the way, and he's Richter's granddad. And the episode ends, so we move on to episode 6, Guilty Men to be Judged. And it starts with Dralta, who looks great in that outfit, and some other vampires preparing for the arrival of Erzabeth. And there she is, finally. And she speaks like she's Sekhmet herself. Well, what? Why? How? What?
Cut off his head and suck out his brains and spit them into the dust.
God, she's a bitch. And she sucks the blood of some girl. Whatever. We move to Richter and his granddad.
Please call me anything but granddad.
Oh, okay, grandpapa. And Richter is justifiably angry at him for not even seeing him ever since he arrived to France. And he told him that he made a deal with Terra that he would send her money when he can, and she would never tell Richter where to find him, because he's a prick. And that's it. God, that was pointless. And later he tells him his sad story about his wife and friend who died in his arms, which caused him to alienate his daughter and become a huge prick. And yeah, sure, okay, let's give him an excuse. Ah, this sucks. What the hell is the point of any of this? And then we cut to Annette talking with her priestess through this magical communication place, who was happy that she killed their previous master, along with his victims, I guess. And she encourages her to keep fighting and convinced her to give Richter a second chance. It was nice, actually. And we cut to Edward singing, and through the power of opera, he managed to remind another night creature of his previous self. Fine, I'll go with it, I guess. And then we cut to Maria meeting with the abbot, who was preparing for the arrival of Erzabeth.
Do they know?
He's still an abbot, so no. And then she tells him that this can't be worse than black magic, which I agree, but he responds by telling her that he's doing it in the name of God, so of course it's fine. And then he asks her to join him so she could be safe, and she refuses, and rightfully so. And then we cut to Erzabeth arriving with a huge crowd surrounding her, and she waves at them like the Queen of England. And Olrax is staring at the parade from a window and reminisces over the time the colonists came to America and killed his people, and they all said they were doing it for God. Which was his way of warning Mizrak, because how the hell did they think she would leave them to live in peace after she gets what she wants? And I think he's starting to have some doubts. Good! And now Dralta saw the abbot and Maria together, and she'll definitely take advantage of that. But in the meantime, we cut to Richter and his granddad talking about Julia's death. Wait, what? Yeah, okay. They talk more for a little while and get ambushed by vampires, who manage to capture him and his grandpa, and the Russian one starts to taunt him and told him that Erzabeth will torture and kill his adoptive family, and since I'm a sucker for a Slavic accent, I enjoyed listening to him. I like what I like. And then he remembers his friends and gets an enemy power-up that restores his magic. Hip hip hooray! Alright, it was awesome. Amazing even. And I'm sure I would have enjoyed it a lot more if I haven't seen the first series. But I have, so I can't help but feel like Richter's whole character arc is just a watered-down version of Trevor's. So if you think this is good, wait until you see the original. But I can't really complain too much about Richter. It was alright. And then he kills all the vampires, and then Just asked him how he got his powers back, and he said this because he has people to fight for. And I think that's what makes him a weaker version than Trevor, in my opinion. And the episode ends, so we move on to episode 7, Blood is the Only Way. And it starts with Erzabeth giving a speech about what she'll do to the whole world and tells her people to celebrate. God, please get rid of that thing, it's disgusting! and Drolta tells her about Maria and how they could use her to secure the abbot's loyalty. Great! And then we cut to Maria and her mom, who tells her that she only kept her father a secret to protect her, which is fair considering who he is.
I loved him. Perhaps if I had insisted he stayed with us and been a father, he wouldn't have betrayed himself like this.
Aww, now I really want to see their story. And then Tara gets attacked by, "Oh my god, Marie, get a life! You're fucking rich! Just buy yourself another husband!" And then Richter comes and saves the day. Or night. Thank god. And then he confronts Tara about Just. She won't say much.
You're wearing a headband.
Thanks for pointing this out. And then we cut to Erzabeth discussing her plan with Aurax. And it was the same thing she keeps saying, with her all looking intimidating and stuff, and Drolta telling Aurax to bow, and he refuses. She also tells him that he's going to help her conquer America after she's finished with Europe, and asked him to bow again, and he concedes, regretting ever coming to France, I guess. We cut back to our main group and Annette.
Oh, you're back, are you?
Their conversation was actually nice afterwards, and now they have feelings for each other, I guess. We then cut to Erzabeth. Never mind. She tells the abbot that before she does anything, she wants submission?
What do you mean, submission?
Submission.
As in, to worship her, right? And he can only achieve that by sacrificing his daughter. Oh yeah, you shut up! I know what you did with Aurax! And now the abbot is terrified. Whatever shall he do? We cut to the group planning an attack on the abbey, knowing full well that they may need to kill Maria's father, and Tara fully accepts it. They just need to know how he's making night creatures.
He has a machine.
Oh hi, Aurax! So they chase him while he really doesn't want to fight them and tells them to get rid of the machine, but they just won't trust him for some reason.
Just read the fucking book.
Okay. They do just that and concludes that they need to send the machine to hell. Okay, why not? Maria then goes to warn her father and help him escape. And even tells him that they can live together as a family. And he just...
Your sacrifice here will send your soul to heaven.
Yeah, he lost his mind. And Mizrak noticed that too, so he went to warn the group. And I'm glad that this is what got him to turn on him, and not the fact that he slept with someone, cause he has no ground to stand on. And then we cut to Erzabeth causing an actual eclipse.
Impossible.
You tell me! Because the first series makes you think it has a Christian, or more like an Abrahamic sort of lore. For there is one God and a hell and so on. So, are you telling me that the Egyptian mythology is actually real here too? Do you have any idea how that wouldn't make any sense? So what, you're expecting me to believe these other gods didn't beef with each other until today? And you can't have two contrasting ideas like monotheism and polytheism exist at the same time. This makes no sense. At least Drolta looks good. And we move on to the final episode, The Devourer of Light. And why is she a fucking furry? What the hell is even happening? I don't care. I'll just move on to the main group and Mizrak trying to get in the abbey to save Maria and send the machine to hell. So they go inside to fight the abbot, reciting a chapter about Abraham, I think, sacrificing Isaac. It's not the same thing, dude. And they manage to save her and Tara starts to recite a spell to open a portal to hell, while Annette goes to push the machine through it. And on her way, she hears Edward singing, so she goes to save him with the help of two other night creatures that Edward managed to change with the power of Oprah. And then he tells her that he needs to stay to help the other night creatures with his singing. Sure man, whatever floats your boat. And the group is fighting Drolta, it was cool. And then this bitch comes in and she's invincible. How did we get to this? And of course, Terra has to stop her casting to protect Maria, so the portal now is closing before Annette managed to push it through. And I can't help but feel that the only reason why they gave the Abbot this giant-ass Iron Maiden thing is for this plan to fail, because in the first series, we had a Forge Master who uses a hammer to make night creatures. A normal-sized hammer. And of course nothing said in a machine like this can't work, and it can't be because the Abbot isn't really good at being a Forge Master. But in the meantime, I can't help but feel like it was only out of convenience. And that's not the only thing, like with the night creatures. The thing is, the Forge Master takes an empty body and puts a soul, a random soul from hell, and it's in that body. So you're telling me, out of all the souls in hell, he managed to put Edward's and Jack's soul back to their own bodies? The reliance on convenience shows a decreasing quality of the writing compared to the first series, but that's okay. Elizabeth reveals that she doesn't want to kill Maria, but to turn her into a vampire. And since they can't defeat her, Terra offers herself instead, and she tells her it has to be someone he loves.
Do you love her?
Absolutely. I love her with all my heart.
Okay, now you're just mocking me at this point. She accepts, of course, and instructs Richter to take Maria and run away. And with Annette's help, they manage to do that. The Abbot tells them to let them go, but they refuse, cause they don't care. Yeah, you fucked up, good luck sleeping tonight. Or ever, really. She goes after them, but they were saved at the last minute by an angel. And his name is Alucard.
I hope I'm not too late.
Oh, you're late alright. You're so fucking late. First of all, where the fuck were you? And second of all, why didn't anyone know of this ancient powerful vampire before now? And third of all, how did you manage to become even more beautiful than before? And that concludes Nocturne. And it was so disappointing, but still watchable. And when it comes to remakes, it's one of the better ones really, so it's alright. Of course it pales in comparison to the first Castlevania series, that I still recommend you watch. And I know that I would have liked Nocturne a lot more if I haven't seen the first series. And I think they should have kept the focus on the revolution and Aurochs and not introduce Elizabeth at all. But it's not so bad. And definitely not woke garbage like some people started saying. Not everything is political, damn it. And it's definitely not garbage. Although I do hope season 2 would fix the issues it has. Anyway, that's all I have to say. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you all next time.
You didn't want me to know I had an actual fucking grandfather living a few miles away.
No, I didn't. You might expect things from me. Advice.
Oh, brother, this guy stinks!